Hi, my name is Ashit Kumar Srivastava. I'm an assistant professor of law at National Law University, Odisha. I'm offering courses at constitutional law and data protection law. I'm also offering a course on basics of Indian constitution at Odisha State Open University. Today, I shall be discussing about Article 14, 15, 16, 17, and 18, and why they are important for us. Keep in mind, Article 14 is the equality code of Indian constitution. It talks about that we shall have equality. And something for a state like India, which does not have any kind of that, we really require a good article to be there. If you read the Indian preamble, you come to realize Indian preamble talks about equality, but it talks about equality of two things, equality of status and opportunity. Emphasize on the and. That means what? Equality of status and opportunity. It's not an alternate. You get both of things. What are those both things? Status and opportunity, not status or opportunity. In order to make sure that that dream is fulfilled, we have Article 14 giving us a mechanical form of equality. We have Article 15, 16 talking about equality of opportunity. We have Article 17 and 18 talking about the idea of equality of opportunity in public employment and making sure there's equality of status. If you read Article 17 and 18, they talk about the idea of provision of untouchability. Article 18 talks about there shall be no designation apart from academic or army designations, in order to make sure there's equality of status in both the citizens of India. Right. Starting with Article 14 of Indian Constitution, if you read the article, you come to realize there are two terms being used, equality before law and equal protection of law. Equality before law means the idea that no one is above the law. That means a negative implication. That means rule of law. If there is a rain happening outside right now, we all shall get drenched by the rain. No one shall be immune to the rain. That's the idea of rule of law. No one is immune to law. Everyone is below the power of law. It's a negative implication taking from the English jurisprudence. That's the idea of rule of law. The other idea is equal protection of law. That means what? When we shall apply the law, we shall apply the law equally. And that is a positive obligation, which has been taken from the US jurisprudence. Now keep in mind, because Article 14 is mechanical in nature, because Article 14 talks about a clear application of equality, it's not possible for Indian constitution. Why? Because our Indian constitution is a colorblind constitution. And what is a colorblind constitution? It doesn't see any color. It doesn't see any race. It doesn't see any caste. But the problem with Indian society is that we see all of them. We see caste, we see race, we see gender biasness. And it becomes hard for us to implicate equality when we have all these biasness with us. Let us take a story. This is a story about a building. On the top floor lives the king. On the second floor lives the warrior. On the third floor lives the merchant. And on the fourth floor lives the servant. The bottom floor is of the servant. Now keep in mind, to this building there's a staircase. So whenever a king gives birth to a servant, the son uses the staircase and goes to the bottom of the floor. Similarly, if a servant gives birth to a king, he takes the staircase and goes to the king floor. Howsoever, after a few years, an earthquake came into existence. And due to that earthquake, the building never got destroyed, but howsoever, the staircase got destroyed. Due to which everyone inside the building was locked to his own floor. The king, even if he gave birth to a servant, he has to be a king. Servant who gave birth to a king, it has to be a servant forever. Everyone is locked to their floors. And that's the idea of Indian system. We are class certified. We are not able to move up and down. And that's the whole reason. Now, when we have this biased nature of Indian society, how can we apply the idea of equality in a true sense? So if you see Article 14, Article 14, though mechanical in nature, in order to make sure that's not mechanical in nature, we apply the principle of reasonable classification. What is reasonable classification? We make sure that we do equality among the equals, not among the unequals. That means what? While we are giving the idea of reservation, we'll make sure the people who have been biased for centuries, they get an equal opportunity to fight with those people who are in a better position. And that's the idea of affirmative action, to make sure they're able to come at par with those who have been there ever since long. And that's the whole idea of reservation, affirmative action. Now, because Article 14 talks about reasonable classification, we need to make sure that this test is qualified. Let us take an example for that very matter. I was taking a trip to Mathura. It's not far away from my hometown. While I was taking a trip to Mathura, I was trying to get inside this premise of Krishna Janmabhoomi. Now, while I'm trying to take my car inside, that is UP 32, I come to realize something. the policeman is not allowing my car to go inside. All other cars who are UP 85, they're allowed to go inside. I asked this question, why are you doing this? He says for a simple reason. Because UP 85 is the local cars, Mathura car. And last week, someone from outside hit someone and he died. So we were not able to trace his car. Now keep in mind, he's discriminating between two kind of cars. One car is from UP 32 and the other car is UP 85. He says UP 85 is allowed, but not UP 32. That is discrimination. But he gives a reasonable answer to that. He says, because we can trace the cars of origin of Mathura, that's why we are allowing those cars only, not the cars of other places. And that's the idea of reasonable classification. Is there a nexus behind that? So while you're giving affirmative action, you need to show the affirmative action is given to those class of people who have been backward ever since. If not, that classification becomes destroyed. Now, the idea of reasonable classification was used for till 1973. Till the time we had the case of E.P. Royappa versus State of Tamil Nadu. And under which case, they changed the criteria of reasonable classification. They came with a test of manifest arbitrary in nature. So if anything that seems not, which doesn't seem quite justifiable in nature, which seems arbitrary in nature, shall be struck down. This particular test was again revived in the case of Saraya Bano versus Union of India, 2017. When they said that any act, any action of state which seems manifestly arbitrary in nature, it shall be struck down. Now that's Article 14 for us. Keep in mind, there's more to the idea of Article 14, which I shall assume you shall be reading from DD Pursue. Try reading that. In pursuance to Article 14, because Article 14 is a genus to us, Article 14 has a lot of sub-childs to it. The first child is Article 15. Article 15 talks about prohibition of discrimination on grounds of religion, race, sex, caste, place of birth, or any one of them. Now keep in mind, the terminology of Article 15 starts with, the state shall not discriminate against any person. The terminology is, the state shall not discriminate against any person. The term any person shows that Indian constitution is a colorblind constitution. It doesn't see any color. Article 15, clause 1 talks about the state shall not discriminate against any class of people. Article 15, 2 is for horizontal effect. Article 15, clause 2 talks about those kinds of places which are public places on which people should be allowed to go, irrespective of the caste, creed, color, or race. Now keep in mind, Indian constitution is trying to attack two ways, that is the vertical effect and the horizontal effect. Vertical effect is between the state and the citizens. Horizontal effect is between us as citizens of India. We shall make sure any places of entertainment, that is malls, cinema theaters, all these are not a place of discrimination. You cannot say, you know what, only this class of people are allowed in this particular cinema hall. That's discriminatory in nature. Why? Because this particular hall is a public place. And because it's a public place, everyone can go there. A famous case upon this is the Sabarimala issue which just came out. The other clause is 15 clause 3. 15 clause 3 talks about making special provisions for women and children. We already know that women have been discriminated against for centuries. And somewhere down the line, 15 clause 3 is an affirmative action making sure that women are being brought at par. We come to realize that Article 15 clause 4 wasn't there initially, but it was added by the First Amendment 1951 to overrule the case of Chappakkan Thorai Rajan versus State of Madras. It gives the power to the state government to make reservation in favor of Scheduled Caste, Scheduled Tribe, or SCBC. That is socially and educationally backward class. Now keep in mind, this is the end of Article 14 and 15. We shall meet you in the next lecture with Article 16, 17, and 18. Thank you very much.